Take it away, Elizabeth.
Okay, fantastic. All right, so what I'd like to do is just give you a quick outline of what we're doing today. We're going to start by reviewing the Boeings, and I'm going to just show how they are kind of speechy in their nature, or how words can kind of be put to them. And then I'll give you a couple of examples of musical applications of these Boeings. So you can see, I'm not just like giving you some pointless exercise, but this is stuff that actually inhabits, these Boeings inhabit Baroque music all the time, all the time. We'll return to the Boeings at the end of the class and expand on our understanding of how to use them a little bit before the following class. And in between, I'm mostly going to talk about rhetoric. Now, rhetoric is a complicated subject. It has two parts in a way. It has compositional rhetoric, in other words, what the composer has put into the music to make it speech-like and comprehensible and meaningful and vivid. And then there's performance rhetoric, which is what all of us are engaged in when we play our instruments. We're trying to make our performance, our delivery of the music that has been written so craftily, we're trying to make that performance vivid and eloquent and expressive and moving and all of those things, have a good strong affect or effect even on our listeners. Okay, so let's circle back to those Boeings. And we're gonna start with Boeing number one, which is just a rounded bow stroke, a gentle beginning, immediate pressure, and then immediate release after lower half of the bow only. You're practicing following through a rounded arm gesture, coming in almost not audibly, in the words of Leopold Mozart, with a pleasant softness. That's how he says you should begin your stroke. So you start above the string, go down, go deep, and then release and let the resonance complete the decay of the tone. Let's just do a few of those at your own pace or with me as you like. So. You really want to hear a real increase in your volume and a real decay at the end. That is the sign you're doing it right. So. Ms. Brandis! It's like patting a cat. It's like petting a kitty. You start gently because you don't want the cat to scratch you, right? And then you follow the curve of the cat's back, and then you taper off near the tail, right? It's a lot like petting a cat. It's a wonderful thing to do, both to the violin and to the cat. So, okay, so that's that first bow stroke. The second one is basically the same thing. It's a little more awkward going on an up bow because it's harder, far away from your hand. It's easy to fall into the string and get a clunking sound, right? So your gesture has to be very sure. You have to become used to where the string really is and go in very gently. And then dip down, carve down into that string with your forefinger, increase the sound, and release at the frog. Try not to, this kind of, the kind of motion that's in two dimensions, you're really looking for the sense of a circle, part of which is audible, a curve in the sound that's audible while you're in the string, going deeper and releasing. So you can see how different that is from, or that's a very neutral sound without shape. And given that expression, as we talked about last week, exists mostly in the bow, it's really important to get as much dynamic contour into your bow strokes as you can. Okay, the third bow stroke is the one where we add a little up bow to that big fat down bow. So, And the idea is not, right? Not a declarative but a ho-on, ho-on, or something like that. You're trying to crescendo immediately on that little up bow. And then pay it off into a big fat down bow. You don't need to move fast. In fact, a slow bow is a wonderful thing. Like petting the cat again. You're not going to go like, whoo, cat, how'd you like that? Right? No, this is not how to pet a cat. So think about your animal here and really dip down. Caress the string with the bow. It should sound warm and shawa, shawa, shazam. Yeah? Just a beautiful, rich kind of a sound. You can work on this, right? This is just a new thing for a lot of us, because most of us are trained absolutely to be in two dimensions, to keep the bow on the string and to make a smooth bow change inside the string. This is asking for something, you know, an extra dimension. That's not trivial. So the last of those bowings was the opposite of the third one, in which the fat sound comes first, and then there's this little smoky drifting away up bow at the end. So so you're not going to hear it, right? Not a big, flat, simple thing, but I won't say that this is like petting the cat backwards, because cats really hate that, but maybe it's like petting the cat with the back of your hand or something. Think of it as that. You're still petting the cat, okay? Just let that up bow just float off the string. Okay. These last two bowings, okay. You can do a couple more if you want to, or I can carry on. We're gonna come back to them again once at the end. Okay, so these last two bowings are particularly important, but let's just go through them, and I'm gonna just sort of give you some ideas about how they have kind of easy to conjure analogs in speech. That first bow stroke is kind of like saying, hey, yeah, or so, right? Wah, yeah, hi, right? It's got a declarative kind of rich quality. It's not like hi or hi, right? Hi, wah. It's speech-like. It is inflected the way we would say hi, especially to somebody we really like. Hi, somebody we haven't seen in a long time, like you guys. I haven't seen you for a week. All right, the second one be on the up bow, because the up bow is a little lighter in the baroque bow. You might want to think of it as a thing like and, or or maybe a preposition like to, for, that it's a kind of connective kind of quality. So you have declarative open down bows, connective up bows, right? That way you are connecting stronger and weaker elements, okay? And then you have bowing three, hawa, the shazam bowing. And there's so many words you can think of. You can think of your own. Hello, goodbye, today, you know. All of these things are weak to strong. And then the fourth one, of course, is the opposite, strong to weak. Music, mother, ice cream, if you say ice cream. Some people say ice cream. I'm more of an ice cream person. I really am. Carpet. I'm just looking around the room. They're everywhere. You table, right? Rocker, sofa. I mean, they're everywhere. Strong to weak, right? So when you use these bowings, you have already taken the first step towards playing in a rhetorical style, right? That's actually a big deal. Now, I'm going to just give you a couple of examples of applications of these bowings in actual reasonably familiar music. Hang on. Okay, so the first two I'm going to exhibit together, the hum and the hum, the declarative and the connective. Think of the Bach's E major violin concerto. and so on. There's going one in a brisk form, a connecting tissue, and another declarative note. Those are bowings one and two, one after the other, right? Okay, and then we have bowing number three, papa, papa, or shazam. If it's gentle, it's kawa. And if it's more brisk or bright, it's ta-da, right? Like you say ta-da, there it is. And here's a fine example from Bach, from the Magnificat, the Deposuit in the wrong key. Right? So there it is. It's a very brisk version of, right? It's the same gesture, weak to strong, but in a very forceful version, which you'll hear more of that piece later. Okay, in bowing four, it's hard to find a piece that actually begins with ta-da. You might be able to think of one. I just couldn't. So I found something where you'll hear it a little later into it. This is a wonderful little duet aria. I think it's Cantata 106. I forget which. Yeah, I think it's 106. Oh, there it is. Right? And those are the words, because there's a text, of course. It's an aria. Jesu, oh Meister, right? So these are words like mother and music. Jesu, Meister, and there's that bowing corresponding with that text, right? Ba, ba, right? So this is not just some random separate kind of technical exercise. This is how I feel that technique should be practiced in Baroque music, that music actually dictates your technique. Technique in Baroque style is the thing you do that makes the music expressive and sound right. Now that's a little different from what you do when you're practicing technique in modern style, because there's so much demanding later repertoire. You have to be able to do, you know, fingered octaves, 1 and 3, 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4, in tune. Good God, it's horrifying. It's perfectly, you can't, the music tells you what to do, but by gosh, you can't do it unless you do a lot of technical work, right? This is a little more, you're a little more connected. This music is not technically as challenging as late Romantic repertoire, for example, and it invites, because it's expressive and usually either suggests or has a text of a certain character, it invites understanding. So allow yourself to be invited, because you'll just progress much more happily if you remember your technique is all musically based. Okay, so now we're going to talk about musical rhetoric on the compositional level, the part that composers have put into their pieces to make them more vivid and more just to enhance a text. You might say, you know, first let's say, what is rhetoric? Well, rhetoric is the ancient classical art of persuasive, effective public speaking, public oratory. If you want to find out about it, you can read direct from the drink from the fountain, from the original source, from Cicero and Quintilian. There are books out there on public oratory. They're not the easiest books to read, but they're informative and interesting. And clearly, this was not just a craft, it was an art form. People took it very seriously. They taught other people how to be rhetorical and effective in their speeches. And you got to say, there's a really good reason for that. Let's say you wanted to be a senator in Athens. You had to get up and talk to people. And there are other people who wanted to be senators too. And believe me, the most effective speaker got to be the senator. If you wanted to be Caesar in Rome, you had to be able to face down a bunch of extremely talented talkers. It was kind of a spectator sport, and there were winners and losers, right? It was a very well-developed public art. It makes a big difference, this business of effect. It's no wonder that the composers and artists of the late 16th century fastened on to rhetoric as a way to try to improve text setting in music. It's almost a no-brainer. It was bound to happen, I think. Effect is everything. And in fact, immediately as this idea caught fire around Europe, and it did. It particularly was a major conflagration north of the Alps. People went completely berserk. The German-speaking world just went right to the end of the line with it, as we will be focusing on, as you'll see as we go on. Effect is everything. I mean, as a public speaker back in the Roman days, you could advance your career, right? If you were a general, let's take an example of a bad speech. A general, the Visigoths or the Huns or somebody are at the city gates, right? And your job is to marshal the troops to get out there and defeat them in battle. So you get up there and you go, "Oh guys, the enemy's like almost here. I think you better put on your sword and get your shield and say bye to your sweetheart, because you might not be coming back." This is like a really bad speech, right? This is really poor rhetoric, and it would not work. You would not be a general for long. Transposing this whole idea of rhetoric to music actually makes sense if you're trying to heighten the effect of a text. Now, just like a speech, you write it, you practice it, you deliver it. Composition, there's a very great analog here. A composer composes a piece of music. He or somebody else practices it, and then they perform it publicly as effectively as possible. So it's a very nice analog. And ultimately, it's fair to say that it's an easy translation to some degree, because we're talking about languages. Spoken language is an obvious thing for human beings. We all do it. Almost all, every person. And music is also a language, and it has become more explicitly a language through the efforts of these early rhetoricians. Okay, so I'm going to give you a little thing to think about that we'll come back to. Notice that setting text in this very way requires that music must conform to the phrase lengths of human utterances, human phrases. Poetry, this is all verbal stuff. And our breath and the sense that we make with our sentences and our clauses and phrases take a certain amount of time. They have a certain duration, right? You'll find that in Baroque music, phrases and the implicit clauses and phrases that are part of whole sentences have very similar structures to human speech. So it's not just inflection, strong words and weak words, or strong syllables and weak syllables. It's the whole big picture of how you speak well. Okay, so moving on, here we go. I think you probably got the idea why they wanted to do this, because it's gonna make the text more brilliant. The other reason, really, this is kind of interesting, the Renaissance was kind of a hotbed of a new idea culturally, which was fascination with people and their feelings and their behaviors. It's no accident that opera got going very soon at the very close of the Renaissance. Opera being a form that glories in watching people do the stuff they do in ridiculous and moving and wild circumstances quite often, just to give people a forum to do all the things that people do, right? And this was massively fascinating to people of this time. It wouldn't probably have happened much earlier. So people were being satisfied by this new focus on human beings through opera, and they were being in sacred music, like in the Passions and the Masses of Bach, they were being educated and having their souls improved by having this music explicitly and eloquently put forth to them. What really happened is that the Italians didn't codify all of these rhetorical devices as thoroughly as the Germans did. And in England and in France, although the rhetorical approach is absolutely evident, it's really north of the Alps that theorists and composers really just got down into it. I can't help thinking that this has something to do with the German national character, even before it was Germany. They have been long known for thoroughness, application, deep philosophical thought, just taking things very seriously. And boy, did they ever do that in this realm. Okay, so I would like to give you a very funny quote. I think it's an extremely harsh quote from one of the early German theorists named Johann Mattheson, who was also a very good composer. And he said about affect, the main goal of rhetorical music, to have a character and a feeling that everybody could really get, right, and feel themselves. He said, everything that occurs without affection, that's his word for affect, means nothing, does nothing, and is worth nothing. Well, that's pretty strong language. Thank you, Mr. Mattheson. I mean, obviously people have to learn to do this, but so don't be discouraged by Mr. Mattheson, right? Just be aiming for meaning something, especially in the shape of your bow when you're performing. All right, so basically he's just saying if your performance doesn't actually grip people in some kind of emotional state, put them into it, you might as well just not bother, right? So I find that rather harsh, but it's kind of fun to hear people being harsh, people from 400 years ago getting it on out there. Okay, so here is a list of words, of conditions or feelings that rhetoricians believed were accessible for translation into musical terms. Rejoicing, weeping, fearing, wailing, mourning, pleading, raging, laughing, and pitying. Standing, running, dancing, resting, leaping, lifting, lowering, ending, descending, heaven, hell, mountain, abyss, and heights. Quickly, fast, soon, slowly, early, late, twice, thrice, four times. That one's trivial, right? Twice, so you do it twice, and you make your point. That one's easy, right? And then you get again. Okay, you could probably do that one too. Once more, same difference. Often, yeah, and rarely. Rarely? How are you going to show rarely? I don't know. There it is, though. This was considered fair game to try to communicate. Night, day, light, darkness, and childhood, youth, and old age, and even inner sentiments like, or characteristics, traits like haughty, humble, contemptuous, inferior, and odious. Whoa. Well, in fact, you might think that those are pretty daunting for people, for composers to take on with pitches and rhythms, right? That's your tools, pitches and rhythms, folks, and articulations of those pitches. That's all you got. And yet, boy, did they go for it. The composers went for it. Handel just, he did it. He can convey contempt. He can convey haughtiness. He's just figured out how to use the language in pitches and rhythms. And he's not alone. Many of them could do this. I think it's time for a little example. So we're going to go back to a little video of the Bach Magnificat, the De Posuit again. And in this time, we're not studying the fact that it goes ta-da at the beginning, but we're talking about a piece that has been set in a way that it vividly and viscerally illustrates its text. Okay, the De Posuit, the text of this is, he has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. So you'll hear this in just a minute. Lolly's going to screen share. It's the Netherlands Bach Society. And you will hear the mighty being brought down in a series of downward directed phrases. And then you will hear the righteously triumphant rising figure, which is depicting lifting up the lowly. Okay, let's have this one now. Yes, stop. Super. That's great. That's perfect. That's
wonderful. Sorry.
There it is. Thank you. Okay, so there you have it. I'm sorry to cut off the tenor. I mean, that's just a rude thing to do to a tenor or any singer. But in the interest of time, you'll hear him sing very similar things. So there you heard it. There's this kind of tussle of up and down, because those are the two sentiments that are most needing to be displayed. the bringing down of the mighty and the lifting up of the lowly. And you can hear it even in the interplay between the bass and the violins. When the bass goes down, the violins go up and vice versa. And you hear like four descending figures from the violins. Ba-dum, ba-da-di-di-di-di-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-da-da-da-da-dum, ba-da-bum, ba-da-be-dum, be-da-dum, be-da-dum, be-da-pum, bum, bum, ba-da-da-di-da-da-da-di-da-da-da-di-da-di-di-dum. And then the lowly are going to get theirs. First try. Woo! Yeah, I got it. And then this fling that's completely unnecessary and brilliant. This huge octave, just like, take that, right? You mighty, we gotcha, right? So it's an incredibly vivid thing. And if you've ever heard the term word painting in music, which I'm sure you have, this is that. He is painting, bringing down and rising up, right? That's why this piece sounds that way. And it is a gripping piece. It's a wild ride, this piece, because of all the ups and downs, and also because of the incredible satisfaction of the lowly triumphing over the mighty. This is like everybody's dream text. This is the revenge of the humble, right? It's fabulous. So it's pretty great. We'll get some more examples of things as we go on. Okay. Remember that long list of attributes and traits and ideas and concepts that people thought they should be able to show in music? That was what they thought they should show around the beginning of the 1600s. 100 years later, that list had nearly doubled. People were so convinced that anything could be made evident with the right rhetorical device. If they put it in their music, it would be clear. I gotta say, I can't entirely agree. It has seemed to me as I've studied some of these rhetorical figures that some of them are better than others. Some of them are more viscerally obvious. Some of them just work no matter what. You start getting into some really abstruse ones like showing respect, and you have a little dip in the pitches. It's supposed to show a bow. Well, maybe. Maybe you could get there if you're exposed to enough of this music and heard enough pieces that had bowing and that were involved with bowing. You might figure it out. But if you didn't, it might be more like, let's see, I got to go look that up, right? You need a glossary, you know, to sort of sort out what that particular device meant, right? So those are not so brilliant, I don't think. But many of them are, in fact, viscerally and immediately obvious to the listener. And those are the ones that are really good to know about. Okay, let's see, I'm gonna pick up, I've been like riffing off of my notes and now I have no idea where I am. Oh yeah, this is very good now. Okay, so far, yeah, I've been talking about music that has a text, right? Because as a matter of historical fact, the whole rationale for this rhetorical experiment was to make the text more vivid, more apparent, more comprehensible, just to brighten the whole thing up. That was the mission, right? Virtually all sacred music involves singers delivering texts. And the opera, the secular but still very text-oriented form, which took off at this point in time with the rhetorical music, it's not so involved in trying to educate or improve, but just to make people enjoy. Well, here's the thing. If so much of this Baroque music is dependent on a text for the music's disposition and employ how the music is deployed in there, what happens when you don't have a text? What happens when you just have instrumental music, right? Right. Is it a whole different style of composition? No. In fact, I like to think of instrumental music from this time forward as what Mendelssohn beautifully called in his piano collection, songs without words. Right, which I further translate as a piece of music that should have or could have words, but just doesn't. And I have to say, composers were really successful, and I can prove how successful they are at creating music that feels like words. All you have to do is Google classical music themes with made up words. You will find a whole lot of really stupid texts stuck to famous classical music themes. I will give you a few examples and you can go dig up the rest of the appalling pile of crap that this endeavor has produced. Here's one from Schubert's Unfinished Symphony. This is the symphony that Schubert wrote and never finished. Perfect. The scansion is admirable. Perfectly good, right? Somebody heard words there and found great words for it. Here's the last movement of Mozart's G minor symphony, number 40. It goes like this. Bum 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 buddy bum buddy bum buddy bum. That's the last movement. And here's the text. The inimitable and most exalted perfect text. Poor Mozart's in the closet. Let him out, let him out, let him out. But so seriously, this stuff's all over the internet. You can find it. And I'm going to give you one really rude example, which will be as rude as I get tonight, I promise. And this is a fugue theme from one of Handel's Concerti Grossi. You've got a booger in your nose. Okay, I'm done being rude. That's it. But this is a silly thing, right? This is silly, but it points to a truth. It points to the fact that this music is inherently speech oriented. The ease with which we put text to these tunes is testament to how successful composers were at creating music that follows the structures, patterns, and inflections of human speech. So I think that's really very cool. I just love this whole topic. Okay, you may notice that my first example was from the Romantic era, then one from the Classical, and then one from the Baroque. The truth is, this music, this rhetorical experiment did not begin and end with the Baroque era. Those theorists and composers at the end of the 16th century built this rhetorical engine, which has been driving Western music ever since. Yes, rhetorical music is transformed as you move through time. The role of melody becomes so powerful that it sometimes, and in fact more recently, kind of almost threatens to overwhelm the underlying rhetoric. Melody has become, I won't call her a cancer, but I will say that she's gotten a little too big for her britches. But you can see rhetorical impulses in the structures and the good performances of music throughout Western music. So that's kind of cool. Okay, so now getting into the nitty-gritty here about these rhetorical figures, that's what you call a thing you do in your composition that is designed for a specific kind of effect, right? Classical orators named each of the devices that they embedded in their speeches, right? These Latin and Greek names, very beautiful names, were retained by the Baroque theorists and composers who translated them into musical terms, okay? There's a wonderful book by Dietrich Bartel, which I may have mentioned last time. I've been teaching a lot and I can't remember who I've talked about this to. It's called Musica Poetica. The first third of the book or so is a very good historical sort of resume of the development of the rhetorical style, particularly in Germany, or what is now Germany. And the rest of it is kind of an encyclopedia of all of these different theorists and composers' concepts of various rhetorical figures. They agree sometimes, they disagree in other cases about what they are. They have alternate names for them, mostly Latin and Greek. But there they are. And so I think it's time now for us to illustrate a few of these figures. Possibly the most important is one where the kind you just heard in De Posuit. It's called hypotyposis, a Greek term. And here is a theorist's definition. It is that through which one provides a detailed description of something, seemingly painting it before the eyes of the listener. Word painting, right? Hypotyposis. Okay, so the example we're going to have here now is just going to be a little rest from my oratorical style. We're going to listen to, a third or a half of Vivaldi's Winter, the slow movement. You could pick any movement of Vivaldi's Seasons. They're a particularly fine example of word painting because there actually is a text for Vivaldi's Seasons. People don't all know that. He was working from a little sonnet, a set of sonnets about each season. And when he wrote his score, where he was imitating the effect of that line of the sonnet, he wrote that line into his score. So each effect of each line is faithfully replicated in musical terms, faithfully painted for you. And so, as I say, just to sort of mellow out, we'll hear some of the slow movement of Winter. And this is Cynthia Freifogel playing with the Voices of Music fantastic violinist and a very ornate and lovely performance. Okay, so that's such a restful and lovely thing. And now I can tell you, but you might not, I don't know if you had, could see any of the stanza, you know, the lines of the poem. In some YouTube videos, you can see them. All that's really going on there is saying something along the lines of how wonderful it is to be indoors on a cold night, enjoying comfort and warmth. And you can feel how lovely that is. And then it mentions the rain. And I don't know if you noticed, but the bass is going all the way through. Those are the raindrops, right? Very simple word painting and so instantly affecting, right? You just, you can't help having your blood pressure just drop to listen to something like this. It is a beautiful depiction of all of those things. Okay, we're gonna have an exciting, a very exciting but brief video now, in which you're going to learn two more musical rhetorical figures. One is called an abruptio, and the other is called an ellipsis. An abruptio is when the music inexplicably and suddenly just stops, right? Boom, very abrupt, so abruptio. And then an ellipsis is when, yes, it, in addition to stopping suddenly, it stops in a way that you're frustrated because it was clearly going to do a certain thing in terms of its melody or its harmony, and it's completely interrupted. You don't get the closure that you were expecting from the line. And instead, you get something completely different. So these are the two things. An abruptio where the music just stops, which is very dramatic when you don't expect it. And the other one is an ellipsis, where the music stops in the middle of itself and then goes on in an entirely different way. Okay, so we'll now hear, I think what we've got here is John Eliot Gardner and the English Baroque soloists, and this is Handel's Overture to Agrippina, or at least a small chunk of it.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Sorry about that. Okay, forget that. Go back to our page and not click on the ad.
That's it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so there you heard the music went diddle 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 da. Who knows what's going to happen? Diddle 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 da tito ti papa. Ooh, that's terrible chromatic dissonant oboe solo. Totally frustrating your expectations, right? Very dramatic move. And I have to say, Handel actually employed, I just noticed listening to that, he employed yet another rhetorical device called, delightfully, a bombus. A bombus is four repeated notes. And the first thing you heard was da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- actually got three for the price of one there, the Bombus, the Abrupt Show, and the Ellipsis. So that's pretty fabulous. Okay, then we have two very important ones. They're, again, these are all pretty brilliant and obvious, effective devices. I'm gonna just sing this one because I didn't pump up a video for it. But an anabasis is a rising figure, often associated with joy, exuberance, hopefulness. And the example I'm gonna just sing real quickly is bum 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 bum. This is from Bach's B minor Mass, in case you couldn't recognize it. It's my terrible voice, right? That is the Et Resurrexit. Bum 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 bum. Resurrecting, right? Coming back from the tomb. Bum 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 bum. Right? Very simple, very effective. You feel the exuberance. You feel you practically would become conscious that this is a rising figure and Jesus is rising, listening to that. And that is the intent, right? Then the opposite of this is the katabasis, the falling line, usually employs dissonant harmonies, often in minor mode, not always, but we'll hear an example of that now from Purcell's Dido and Aeneas. This is the famous Dido's Lament. We'll hear maybe three times through this descending bass line.
Just tell me when to stop, because I can't.
You can, shall I wave at you, or? And you may have noticed that the singer has often upward lines when she's, when I am laid, right? She's going up, I'm laid in earth. She's talking about being laid in earth and down she goes, right? These are just, again, very simple devices that really work. They create the feeling immediately. You know you're in for a mournful time when you hear the beginning of that katabasis. Okay, I'm gonna show you another katabasis by personal demonstration, along with a second, yet another one of these things. How are we doing for time? Because I could go on like this forever. Oh my gosh. Can you stay for like 5 or 10 extra minutes, do you think? Okay, cool, because I'm not gonna get through it otherwise. All right, so this is from Bach's Musical Offering. This is a long story, which since I don't have much time, I will not tell you, but I do encourage you, if you're not familiar with the story around the Musical Offering, go to Wiki and read the story. You can probably find better versions of the story, but that's a good introduction. But suffice it to say that Bach went to Potsdam to visit his son, C.P.E. Bach, who worked there for the King Frederick the Great, who was kind of a jerk. And King Frederick had heard a lot about Bach and thought, Bach probably thinks he's pretty hot stuff. I'm going to show him. And King Frederick was a bit of a musician, and he wrote a theme. There is some doubt whether he actually wrote the thing. Some people think that C.P.E. Bach may have written this extremely tortured and difficult theme as a way of getting all bad in trouble. But what actually happened was King Frederick showed the theme to Bach and said, okay, now improvise a three-part Richard Carr on this theme. And Bach, because he was Bach, sat down and did it. And then went home and wrote it all out note for note later, right? A brilliant, long, and difficult three-part Richard Carr. And King had his nose put out. I see now I'm telling the story. I can't help myself. The king had his nose put out of joint because Bach had done exactly what he'd asked. So he said, okay, well, all right then, do it in six parts. Well, that was a toughie. And Bach had to say, Your Majesty, sire, I cannot do that upon the spot, but I will do it and send it to you. And he did. And the six-part Richard Carr is one of the most glorious pieces of instrumental music based on a really gnarly and horrible theme that ever could possibly exist. So Bach really got the last word for sure. And the whole musical offering consists of a trio sonata on the theme. It consists of innumerable, unbelievably clever canons with inversions and retrograde and diminutions and augmentations, all the possible composerly tricks that Bach was such a master of, and very few other people could come close to. They're all there, and it's just a stunning piece of work. So the theme goes like this, and you're gonna hear at least two rhetorical devices, one of which is the katabasis you just heard in Dido. So here's the theme. So you recognize the katabasis now, right? Mm. That chromatic downward thing, very melancholy, defeated, kind of creepy even because of all that chromaticism, right? So the other little rhetorical element there, or one of them, is this moment here where you go, this nasty big interval, that is called a saltus duriusculus. I love these words. They're such great words. Saltus comes from like somersault. It means to leap. So it's a leaping interval. It could go down or it can go up. In this case, it goes down. And it's almost invariably a dissonant interval. Mm-hmm. Not very nice interval, right? Very kind of painful. So this was a very learned theme, which kind of points towards, in my opinion, C.P.E. Bach, who had learned rhetoric at his father's knee. It sounds to me like he might have written this theme. I'm in love with that theory anyway. Okay, so one more example on video from the Bach musical offering. This is one of his canons. You'll hear the theme with an extra part added. So it's for keyboard, for two parts. This is a fake keyboard. It's a mechanical keyboard, what do you call it? A computer, electronic keyboard. But what Bach does here is twist at the end of it so that it modulates up one whole step. And then that repeats. And of course it twists again and it modulates up another whole step, and it can keep going all the way through, all the way back up to the, so it's called, like some people call it, the infinite canon. This is called an auxesis or incrementum. And the point of this, rhetorically, the thing that the king was supposed to understand from this, that this is my favorite one in a way, because the king was supposed to get from this, that this was this incrementing thing, is to show how the king's glory increases, right? How his glory, his wisdom, his might, his influence increase infinitely. It's supposed to be a form of homage. And it's one of the creepiest things you'll ever hear. So I feel like Bach got the last word here as well. He managed to make a really creepy piece in praise of King Frederick. So let's have this one.
Thank you.
if you keep listening to this thing, it gets creepier and creepier as it gets higher. It gets more and more tense feeling. So it's really a great way of actually dissing the king while appearing to show how great he keeps getting, right? So that's kind of cool. All right, so I think that's probably enough as just to sort of give you a kind of an introduction to what these composers were up to. They were really, really, they took this stuff seriously. And I picked examples deliberately that have a strong effect because they're more interesting. They're the money shots, as it were, you know? They're really wonderful. So now let's talk about performance rhetoric. We're gonna end the class beginning to talk about performance rhetoric, and that will occupy us for the remainder of the classes because after all, we're talking about performance here, right? We're not composers. But I think it's really important. I don't think I ever actually addressed the reason it's important to know what a composer is up to with his rhetoric. And the reason now should be pretty clear. If you spot one of these things, one of these devices, you have a giant clue, a giant effective clue, what the character of the piece is and how you might want to play it. So it's informative for you too, as performers, to recognize these devices when they occur in the music. Okay, so on to performance rhetoric. All right, so if you're going to be speaking your music rather than simply painting it with a big broad brush stroke or a big long tone, right? If you're gonna try to inflect it and all of that, you've already started doing that with the bowings that we've been working on, right? You need several skills. Most of them are skills that you would need if you were delivering a speech, naturally. Now this should seem like a very natural relationship between speech and music, I hope. Let's consider some of the things you need one by one. First, you need adequate inflection. We all know the annoyance of listening to a person who drones on, and we know how quickly we simply stop listening. Good inflection often partners with good diction. Right, what just happened, right? That's really terrible. I shouldn't talk to you like that. Nobody should, right? We all know how annoying it is to listen to somebody who drones on, and we know how quickly we simply stop listening, right? Good inflection often partners with good diction. Yeah. So that's one of the skills that you want to be thinking about when you're playing. You don't want to just lay your bow down on the string and do this. You want to find the important things, inflect them, find the unimportant things, and lighten up or lift your bow so you're not droning on, right, in a horizontal way. Okay, a second kind of thing you might need is a good dynamic range. If the dynamic range of the voice is small, even with adequate inflection, the effect quickly becomes annoying, sing-song, and feels limited, because it is, right? So if your dynamic range is tiny, you can be inflecting and you can talk clearly, but it's really kind of god-awful to listen to, right? So a really substantial dynamic range is part of your toolkit. Third, appropriate punctuation, the equivalent, musical equivalent of punctuation. I've written a very, very short speech, which includes commas, periods, exclamation points, question marks, and a colon, not in that order. And first I'm going to read it without exhibiting the punctuation. I went to the grocery store and on my shopping list were carrots, canned peas, ice cream, wine, and rutabagas. Do you like rutabagas too? I love them. Right? No punctuation, very little meaning, really annoying if you had to listen to that, whether it's musical or with words. And would you put the punctuation back in? It's not gonna, save the earth, but at least it's comprehensible in meaning. I went to the grocery store and on my shopping list were carrots, canned peas, ice cream, wine, and rutabagas. Do you like rutabagas too? I love them. Actually, I don't. I don't think I've ever eaten a rutabaga, but whatever. So punctuation is really important. Fourth, variety in tone, meaning tone of voice. Matching your tone to the character of the piece is really important. For example, here's a little bit of Joyce Kilmer's famous poem, Trees. I think that I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree. A tree whose hungry mouth is pressed against the earth's sweet flowing breast. A really gross misuse of tone of voice. Really, truly, truly gross, right? So when you're a string player, what you're looking at for tone of voice is variety of bow speed, variety of placement. Are you close to the bridge for that brighter, harsher tone, which I just used so inappropriately in the poem? Or a more dulcet pastel quality by getting down away from towards your fingerboard, where the string is more elastic and can't take as much pressure. You have to be very pet the cat about treating the string nicely down there. You'll get a very bad sound. And the last, not by any means a comprehensive list, but another thing that you want to have as one of your tools is beauty of tone. We all work on that. I continue to work on beauty of tone. It's sometimes feels like an elusive goal, but well worth pursuing. The truth is, I mean, who's going to rent the book on tape of Wuthering Heights read by Donald Trump, right? Nobody's going to rent this one. You'd much rather hear, like, I don't know, Morgan Freeman or Cate Blanchett, somebody with great diction and an expressive voice, right? And understanding what they're saying, which is not always the case with Mr. Trump. Okay, so I think we're now at the point where we need our fiddles again, and we're going to do a little bit more on those four bowings, but we're going to work on expanding their reach. Okay, and then we'll call it a night. It's a busy night here. All right. Okay, so to introduce this next aspect of the four fundamental bowings, we're going to focus mostly on bowings 3 and 4. And what we've got here, we had for bowing 3, right? The shazam or the ta-da, right? However you choose to inflect it. But it's weak to strong and a flowing dynamic through both bows, starting soft. You don't actually have to do it again, because what I'm going to ask you to do is a little trickier, but it's kind of fun, okay? Do you remember, I think I read in the a quote from Kvanz, who also worked for King Frederick the Great, poor guy, in the last class, in which I said, he said a brilliant thing about rhetorical music. He said, every note should have its piano and forte as time permits. In other words, if the note's long enough, you're supposed to give it a shape, a messa di voce, the thing we've been practicing, right? And then he said, I paraphrase, if the notes go by too quickly, if there's not time to give the note its own little piano and forte, then your job is to sort out what is the group of notes that belongs together, sort of like a multisyllabic word or a small phrase of several words, and you're supposed to shape that. Okay, so here's how you get to that point of doing that, or at least partway. So if you have bowing shazam, then you might say, what about? We're going to add a little short down bow before that up bow. So you're going to use the least bow on the down bow, more on that little up bow, and then pay off to the big fat down bow, just like before. So tagawa. I don't know. There's the text there. I don't know. Do you know? Let's try it. So very little bow, very gentle start. Immediate crescendo all the way to the down bow, right? Good, I see some nice bow gestures. That's so great. Excellent. All right, so you can see now that you can now extend this, the weak part of this gesture, by adding bows. This is corresponding to Kvanz's statement that when you can't put a shape into a single note, because these little notes you're adding are very short, there's not time to shape them completely individually with their own piano and forte, right? But you can extend, right? And get one more up bow in there. And you can add another down bow before that. Right? And you can do this as long as you want. You can add notes, add small bows, as long as you're making a trajectory, a dynamic trajectory from very weak and light, growing, 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 all the way to the big fat down bow at the end, right? Yeah, I can see it. It's looking good, you guys. Yeah. You go. Right. Okay, so that's that direction, and it's kind of obvious what's going to happen with the other one, which is the strong to weak. You're going to add a little weak note before, a little down bow at the very end, rather. And again, you can add extra bows as long as you maintain that strong to weak trajectory through all those little bow strokes. Okay, you guys are almost ready to play the Bach double. Right? The Bach double, think about how it goes, right? There's five notes. They belong together. You can tell intuitively that they belong together. Right? They just belong. You know it. Well, whether is it going to be or is it going to be Are you going to crescendo through those notes? Are you going to go weak to strong? Or you're going to go ta-da-da-da-dum, strong to weak, right? You have a choice. This is where your taste and temperament come into play. Let's try the version with the strong to weak first. Keep that rounded arm. Sink into that first note as fast as you can and lighten up your strokes from thereafter. Okay, and then you can try the other version. The other version has a certain validity too, because this piece, I always think this piece kind of starts as if it had been going for quite a while. There's a very active inner voice going in the viola, and you get this more interesting harmony halfway through the bar, and it's in cut time, so you don't want to be hacking too hard on too many beats. So there's a good justification for starting as if you're going weak to strong. So less bow at the beginning, more with each stroke. So. Okay. So this is stuff you can practice. If you want to take a little homework assignment, just entirely on your own, take a piece of music and see if you can start identifying all the little weak to strong gestures, whether they're single note, a single weak note to a strong note, a single strong note to a weak note, or if there's a group of strong notes leading to a taper, or a group of weak notes leading to a stronger event, right? Just see if you can start finding these elements, because you'll find between the two of them, when you start sewing weak to strong and strong to weak together in the course of a phrase, you have created a naturalistic flow of energy that greatly resembles human speech. And that is kind of the whole point, right? That's kind of what we're trying to do with this repertoire, explicitly, consciously, on purpose, first through the composers and how they've written, and then as performers, inflecting and delivering that text. Okay, I think I'm going to go hoarse pretty soon, so I should stop talking.
That was fantastic. Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. Really, this is such a great topic. It is. I have to say, the Dietrich Bartel book, I was blown away when I read that book. I couldn't put it down. It was just like, Really? Oh my gosh. You know, I was just flabbergasted by it. He's a scholar. He's not like a humorous writer at all. It's not like popularized at all. It's pretty serious, but boy, did it hit me hard. I just thought it was fun. You can also, if you'd like the Reader's Digest version, go to Grove's New Dictionary and read the article on rhetoric there. He picks up the author of that article, I've forgotten, I'm sorry, picks up on some interesting points as well. And it's definitely worth a read. It's like a 30-page article in Grove as opposed to a big fat tome from Dietrich Bartel. So if you're curious, and if you're seriously curious, go back and read Cicero and Quintilian. There you go. Yeah, now that's a piece of work.
Yeah. So yeah. Folks, I want to just, as we end today, I want to talk about the access. There were a number of people who had trouble getting in, and the links are on that asset page that I sent you. They're the same links as last week. They're going to be the same links next week. The Eventbrite, for those of you who are registered, the Eventbrite link should get you right in. If not, the Zoom is a backup access, but some people had some trouble logging on to that, and I can't give you any advice about it. I don't know why you had trouble, but I think the Eventbrite is the best way to go. We also have a page that's referred to in that assets, on your assets page, that explains how to make sure your login to Eventbrite will work. So please try and get in by about 9:45 next week, because once we start, I really don't have time to do any troubleshooting. So I really apologize to those who had trouble today, but the video will be posted, as it always is, hopefully by about noon tomorrow, so you can catch up on what you missed. Also, just try and get in a little early next week so we don't start late. And for those of you who have not yet submitted your favorite piece that you want Elizabeth to take a look at, please do that as soon as you can so we can have preparation. That's going to start next week, right? Sort of the middle to the end of next week. So yep, we want to have those in. And that's about it from here. So thanks everybody for coming. See you next Tuesday.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.